All right, so we're moving on tonight, and you know we've talked about creation and corruption, and then catastrophe. So tonight we want to talk about confusion, which is the Tower of Babel event, and it's an event that we overlook a lot because the Bible gives just a handful of verses to it, but it's one of the most significant events in human history. I want to read. Starting with Genesis chapter 9, verse 18, the Bible says, "The sons of Noah who went forth from the ark were Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Ham was the father of Canaan. These three were the sons of Noah. And from these the people of the whole earth were dispersed." So we need to stop there again. And like we said last time, we either believe what the Bible says or we don't believe what the Bible says. And if that is true, and we believe it is, then we are dispersed from one of those three sons of Noah. We can all go tracing back to Noah, which means we can go tracing back to Adam. I didn't do a lot of research on this. I'm not going to go too deep into this part, but there are ancient genealogies even from Ireland and England that trace themselves back to Noah's sons. And you read all these countries, they were named after the sons and the grandsons and the great-grandsons of Noah. And the Bible says, after the flood, Noah lived for 350 years. All the days of Noah were 950 years, and he died. Now, we're not talking about the fall much tonight, but the fact is, every single person we read about in these genealogies ends with, "and he died." Because that is what sin did. You know, with the exception of Enoch and those early generations who was translated, they died. I'm going to go back just for a moment to chapter 6, verse 4. And the Bible says the Nephilim were on the earth in those days. This is before the flood. And also afterward. That is where we get our word for giants. If you're reading King James, it will say there were giants on the earth in those days. And also afterward. When the sons of God came into the daughters of man, and they bore children to them. These were the mighty men who were of old, the men of renown. Now, I want to talk just briefly about that because that's going to play a role, I believe, into what we're about to talk about. And different people will teach different things, but I'm going to tell you what I think the Bible teaches right in front of us. Okay, the sons of God. Who were the sons of God? Well, when you look at the Hebrew and some of the way this is used, it's the same as what is mentioned in Job when the Bible says there was a day when the sons of God presented themselves to God and Satan came among them. This is in heaven, and that he challenges God over the life of Job. So clearly those were angels. So what we believe is that, and we know according to Scripture, when you read in the book of Revelation that when Lucifer rebelled at some time in the past, probably, which had to have happened if we understand the Bible right, after creation, after the 6 days of creation, because God said he created everything good. He said it was very good. And he looked at day six after he created everything in the universe, and he said, "And behold, it was very good." That means Lucifer had not fallen. Okay, at some point after that, Lucifer fell. Okay, we know that, and according to the book of Revelation, a third of the angels of heaven sided with him in his rebellion, and they were cast out of heaven. According to Peter and Jude and some of these others, some of those angels are already reserved in hell awaiting judgment. But some are not. Lucifer is not in hell. Satan is not in hell. So what does all this mean? If according to what people believe, angels came down, they appeared to be human, they married women, they had children, and that's how we got the race of the giants. That is what I believe the Bible teaches. And clearly here it says, and I want to read it again, the Nephilim, or the giants, the Nephilim is a Hebrew, it's coming from a Hebrew word. That's what the ESV says, I'm reading out of it. King James and others will say the giants were on the earth in those days. And also afterwards, when the sons of God came into the daughters of man and they bore children to them. How much more clear does it have to be? That sounds like a science fiction movie, but it's fact. These were the mighty men who were of old, the men of renown. So you look at mythology and you see all these people like Hercules and Gilgamesh and all these. I'm not saying they were real people, but they were based probably on some facts. Because these were the mighty men of renown, well known. And even though the ones before the flood perished, those legends would have continued. They would have remembered. and passed them down. And it says they were also after the flood. There were giants after the flood because Satan did this again in an effort to corrupt the human race, because he doesn't know the whole full story of God, but he does know what God said in the garden, that the seed of the woman is going to crush your head. So he has ever tried to stop that from happening. And you can look at it throughout the scripture. He tried to stop it through polluting, corrupting the human race, and he very nearly won, because all that was left was Noah. Everybody else was wicked. After that, he tries it again through the races of the giants. Go into Joshua and Deuteronomy and those places where they send out the spies and they go to spy out the land. What's one of the reports they came back? We are as grasshoppers in their sight. Goliath, he was a giant. The Bible gives his size probably 8 to 10, 11 feet, depending on what the cubit was at that time. Okay, you can read, I believe, in the book of Judges, forgive me, I didn't write this down, but about this one king, and his bed was like 17 or 18 foot long. All right, and you can go, there's a zoo over in Gate City, somewhere over there, and they have got on the wall, and I'm not teaching this as fact because I've not researched it enough, but they have got different skeletons that have been dug up throughout the centuries showing how tall they were. So the giants existed. The Bible teaches it, and they did exist. They're gone. David, according to the Bible, David and his men wiped out the last of that race, and they've never been able to surface again. But I'm saying all that to say this. Some significant things took place after the flood, and I want to talk about that tonight. I'm going to go now to Genesis 10, verse 8. By the way, Ham, the son of Noah, has Cush. Okay, and the Bible now says Cush fathered Nimrod. He was the first on earth to be a mighty man. That's one way to say it. Another way to say it is he was a mighty man. He was one of the mighty men. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. Therefore it is said, like Nimrod, a mighty hunter before the Lord. In the days that Moses wrote this, that was a common saying. According to some word studies, the reason it says he was a mighty hunter before the Lord could allude to that he was the greatest of the hunters on earth. Okay, we look and we have in mythology and astronomy, you know, Orion is considered to be a mighty hunter. So you have these legends of mighty hunters. Don't think that this was a good thing. Okay, you'll show me the picture of the deer he just got. Mighty hunter. That's not what Nimrod was. Okay, first of all, why would you name your child Nimrod? You know, I don't understand that. But Nimrod, according to some word studies, that mighty hunter before the Lord, basically he was tracking down people and killing them. He was a tyrant. The Bible says very little about him. A lot of study has gone into who he is, and we just don't really know besides what the Bible says here. But he was significant. It's possible, because the Bible says he was a mighty hunter, and he was the first on earth to be a mighty man, this is after the flood, that he was one of the Nephilim. We don't know that. I'm not teaching that. I'm just saying it was possible. But here's what the Bible says. The beginning of his kingdom was Babel, Erech, Akkad, and Kalna, in the land of Shinar. This is Mesopotamia. Even secular history teaches this is the cradle of civilization. All right, now, because after the flood, that's where it was. The ark landed on the mountains of Ararat, which is somewhere, it says the mountains of Ararat. There is a Mount Ararat today, but it says the mountains of Ararat in the Bible. So that just gives a general vicinity of somewhere in the area of modern-day Turkey is where those mountains are. Some people claim it's been found. There's satellite images. I don't know if it's it or not, but you can look that up on your own. But anyway, this is the area. From that land, he went into Assyria, and he built Nineveh, Rehoboth, Ir, Kala, and Rezin, between Nineveh and Kala. That is the great city. And look at all these names. Then there's this guy named Egypt. Okay, Egypt fathered Ludum, Anamim, Lahabim, Naphtahim, Pathrusim, all the hymns and nymphs, from whom the Philistines came. Okay, then it mentions Canaan. This is the son of Ham. And it goes on and lists all these ites, Jebusites, Amorites, Girgashites, Hivites, Sinites, all these people that you see Israel having to defeat later. This is where they came from. So you have all the people being born and the people being dispersed after the ark, because God said, be fruitful and multiply and basically disperse yourself across the earth. He did not command them to stay in one place, yet that's what they did. Now, the Bible says the whole earth had one language and the same words. And as people migrated from the east, they found a plain in the land of Shinar and settled there. And they said to one another, come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly. And they had brick for stone and bitumen for mortar. And they said, come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens. And let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth. I always wonder, what is the big deal that they wanted to build a tower? So what? Well, God said disperse, and they said, no, let us build a name for ourselves so that we're not dispersed. So it was an absolute rebellion against God. No doubt they were probably worshiping everything under the sun, because it didn't take long to see sin re-enter the world. Okay, the next few verses after the flood, you see Noah getting drunk and his son coming in an event that still fully hasn't been explained. Okay, there's something, I believe, much more to what took place than just he walked in and saw his father naked. Now, maybe I'm wrong, and I'm not prepared to teach on that tonight, but something that was significant enough for a curse to get put up on Canaan, his grandson. Okay, so we immediately see sin, and then we have people like Nimrod, and all of this chaos beginning to happen again. So they're rebelling against God, and the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of man had built. And the Lord said, behold, they are one people, and they have one language, and this is only the beginning of what they will do. Nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. That's significant. He said, they've got this, they can do it, and look what they're doing. They've got one language, they're joined together, and look, this is just the beginning of what they're going to do. So God, as he always does before the human race goes too far, stops it. And he did. He stopped it. He said, nothing will be impossible for them to do. Come, let us go down and there confuse their language so they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord dispersed them all over the face of the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore, its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth. And from there, the Lord dispersed them over the face of all the earth. There's another scripture later that names a man named Peleg. Not Peleg, but Peleg. And it says, in those days, the earth was divided. This is probably the same event. Because from here, the different peoples of the earth spread abroad. You want to know why Columbus found Native Americans here? It's because God dispersed them at some point in the past. Even secular science knows there was a land bridge between Russia. There's only 50 miles now between Russia and Alaska. They could have walked here. They didn't have to sail here in boats. Okay, you get to North America, you can walk into South America. That doesn't take a lot of rocket science to figure out how the peoples spread abroad. I don't know how they got to Australia, but they did. Maybe they sailed, but they're there. Okay, and we know they've been there. God spread them abroad, the face of the earth. And that's what I want to talk about tonight, because it's a significant event. You imagine, we talked last week, we don't know how far advanced the human race was before the flood. There is no way we can possibly know that now, because God wiped it out. I absolutely don't believe they were a bunch of grunting cavemen. What I do know from the scripture, they were already working in metal, they were already building musical instruments, and you know, that was taking place early in Genesis. So, and then they used it for their own evil works. And God wiped it out, and they started over. Well, here, according to scholars, this likely happened about 100 years after the flood. They're already building cities because they still had the knowledge of how to do it. They had to start all over. They had the knowledge of how to do it. So they're regaining their technology. But then all of a sudden, it starts all over again because you can't communicate. Nothing gets done. Communication breaks down. Everything falls apart. Everything. I remember about a year ago, right before we moved, there was an accident on the bridge on the interstate behind our old house. And so I immediately called 911. We heard it. No one answers. No one answers the phone. They call me back. And I'm thinking, that's a communication breakdown. You have no emergency services. That's one minor thing. You go to McDonald's. And okay, you might be able to point, but I've gone to McDonald's and their machines are down and they can only sell things off the dollar menu because they can't figure out how to calculate tax. I am telling you the truth. That has happened to me when their machines have been down. You go out, what happens when there's a breakdown of an ATM? Several years ago, something happened to Visa, and for like a whole day, you couldn't use your debit cards, and I was crippled because we were out of town. I didn't know how we survived that day. We figured it out. But I mean, I don't carry cash. I carry like $10. And I use it to pay a parking fee this week. Okay, so I mean, I don't carry cash. I have to dig under the seats for quarters. So, you know, you have that kind of breakdown. Think about what shuts down. Look what we're dealing with shipping issues right now in America. These are minor issues compared to when everything falls apart. And it did. And so once again, they're starting all over again. Man, oh, like, look what we can do. Look what we can do. And God says, I'll show you what you can do. Nothing without me. And they start all over again. And you see that cycle throughout history. Look, you know, Israel. Oh, we don't need God. We can do this fine. I'll send you into captivity. Okay, the Romans. Oh, you know, they thought eternal Rome, Rome the mighty. Well, God said, I'll show you the mighty Roman Empire. Although it lasted over 1,000 years, fell apart and collapsed. Okay, Hitler and Mussolini and these guys. Oh, it's a new world order. We're going to do this. They're in hell today, if I have to say it that way. Because it ended. Well, we think we're all high and mighty. Oh, we don't need God. Jesus is going to come back. He is coming. That's the next big event. You know what? He's coming soon. So, Tower of Babel, was it real? We get made fun of. Yeah, it was real. According to at least this source, and I'm reading just so in case I get sued because of plagiarizing, this is by a guy named Bodie Hodge. He wrote a book called The New Answers Book, Part 2. And by the way, I don't get paid by Answers in Genesis, and they're not the only Christians on earth. I just like a lot of their sources when it comes to this. I think they're the best when it comes to this stuff. So it says the Tower of Babel around 2242 BC was a post-flood rebellion against God by Noah's descendants. God judged them by dividing the single language into multiple language families. As these groups spread out and became isolated, certain features, skin shade, eye shape, became dominant in certain groups. I'm going to show you in just a few minutes on some slides if I get there. So, and I'm going to sum up a lot of this. I can't read all this. It would just take too long. But if you ever notice, we don't know what the Tower of Babel looked like. We have no idea. There are some people who claim they think they have found the foundation of it. But one thing that we find very familiar is all around the world are these things called ziggurats, these pyramid-type structures. It's very. Why do you think they're found all around the world? Probably because they knew what they looked like when they were dispersed. That's just speculation, but I think it's pretty good speculation. Very well could have been a pyramid shape. Or is there, we think of something, you know, the old pictures of something as tall as the Empire State Building. That's probably not how tall it was. Very unlikely it was that big. It could have been. We don't know. But probably not. So, we notice, according to history, look at where the civilizations rose up. It was those places closest to the Middle East. And then they gradually started rising outwardly. Why? Because some people went just a little bit of a distance. Okay, you got this group of people that speak this language, they went and settled over here because all the languages split. You got this group, and they go settle over here. You got this group, and they go settle over here. So the civilizations closer to Babel, okay, Babylon, Egypt, Greece, this is where they began. And then finally, you see evidence all across the world. You see ziggurats and things in South America, from the Incas and the Aztecs and the Mayans. Already talked about that. So languages. According to at least this source, there are over 6,900 languages in the world today. Others say 7,000 or 8,000. How could this have come from one? Well, it's very possible because even now, many people agree there are even on earth today less than 100 different actual language families. You've got lots of languages, but many are very similar. And they adapt over time. We have a dialect in Southwest Virginia that they don't understand in California. Okay, I can't understand someone talking to me from upstate New York. Sometimes I have a hard time. Okay, the way we speak English is not how they speak it in London. In fact, if you learn Spanish, you learn either Spain Spanish or Mexico Spanish because they're so different. You don't think languages can change? Let me see if I've got this example. Listen to this. Okay, everyone would understand this. Our Father who art in heaven. Okay, between 1500 and 1700, it would have said our Father which art in heaven with a U, not a V. Middle English, 1100 to 1500, our with an E, O-U-R-E, fodder, that art in H-E-U-E-N-I-S. This is English. And then like Old English, can't even recognize it. F-A-E-D-R-E, fodder, U-R-E, some letter that I don't recognize. It looks like a B with a long stick, B-U-B-E, but it looks different than a B. E-R-T, E-A-R-T, on, H-E-O-F-O-N-U-M. Anyone ever had to try to read Beowulf, the original Beowulf? You can't. It's a foreign language to us now, yet that was English 1,000 years ago. So languages are constantly evolving and adapting. We're inventing words as we go. Okay, even in English, words get canceled out, new words come in. Ain't is in the dictionary now. It's not even a word, but it's there. So there was a real event that took place, and it confusion, again, is what we're talking about. So we have diversities of languages starting at Babel, and now I'm going to show you some things on here that I want to get to. Okay, there's your seven C's again. Okay, now that's significant. The Bible talks about things being created after their kind. And so humans produce humans. That's it. We know that, period. And I'm going to talk about race tonight. Before I do, I'm going to be very clear. There's one race, and that's the human race. Even secularists who study genetics will say there is less than 0.02% difference in the different so-called skin colors. Okay, look at that. Everyone on there, what's different? Everyone on earth can tell me what there is different. Okay, everybody. There's one thing that's clearly different there. Okay? Yeah, you got three types of the dog kind and one thing that doesn't fit at all. Okay. I won't talk about that. I'm not going to go through all of this. Okay, so do animals change? Absolutely. Yes. Doesn't teach evolution. There's a point with confusion and Babel behind this. Yes, things change. Things adapt. We know that. We know things can adapt. Okay, go out and find a dog right now, and their hair is growing thicker because it's getting close to winter. Okay, so do dogs change? Yeah, but into different dogs. Dogs change into different dogs. Okay, I put two different breeds of dogs together. I get a mixed breed. Okay, but I don't put a dog and a cat together and get a cog. Okay, you know what? We can mix certain things. They're the same families. You know, there's Z-donks, is what they call the donkey and zebra. They've mixed those because they're the same family. But dogs become dogs. There's a reason for this that I'm getting to. So we you see this, the dog kind. Okay, so, you know, the wolf is universally pretty much agreed to be the common ancestor of modern dogs. Okay, guess what? In that wolf's DNA contains things to be able to produce other kinds of things. Evolution teaches that we're, you know, says that we all started with this one thing and are getting better and better and better and better and better. But look at that. I think probably a wolf is greater than a poodle. Just saying. I don't want to get too technical, so I'm not going to talk much about dogs. Okay, that might be for another night. But there is a reason behind that. You probably remember that from biology. I do want to talk about this because it's going to have to do with Babel in just a minute. So you say, okay, if Noah, we talked about this before, the Bible doesn't say he took two of every species. It says he took two of every kind, which would be equivalent to probably a family today, and if you want to get technical with science. So that means there were two types of the dog family. Within these dogs, there's different kinds of DNA that over time can produce different kinds of dogs. We have new dog breeds in the last 20 years. We do. Imagine this after the ark. Okay, you get dogs that migrate to the north, dogs that migrate to the tropical areas. Which dogs are going to survive in the northern climates? Dogs that have long hair, and those are the ones that are going to survive. They're going to have puppies that have long hair, and those are going to survive. Those that didn't could not survive in those climates, so they didn't stay there. You don't find Chihuahuas in the Arctic Circle, but you don't find Siberian Huskies naturally in Mexico. Okay, because that's not the climate they were made for. These animals went to the place they could survive, and then they produced after their kind. Okay, then this dog did the, okay, so at some point you got a medium-haired dog that has puppies with a long-haired dog. So, you know, you figure it out. We get different variations. Well, there's a point to this again. I want to talk about, don't even want to talk about mutation. Another message. Sorry, I was going to talk about all this tonight, but I've changed my mind. So races, how many different races? We've already said there's one, and that's the human race. And I want you to read this. It says, race is a social construct derived mainly from perceptions conditioned by events of recorded history, has no basic biological reality. See Loring Brace. You can read that there. All human beings are human beings, period. Period. There's one race, and that's the human race. We won't let racism die because we keep creating new ways to keep it going. And that's all this whole mess on critical race theory is. It's another way to keep the same dead argument going. Is there racism? Yes. But it's because people won't let it die. If you don't let a wound heal, it won't heal. You can keep picking the scab off, and it's going to keep bleeding. And it's going to get infected, and it's going to get worse. And that's why, because the media and people who want to point their finger at me and you and call us racists are the true racists, because they want to keep it going. It's nothing more and nothing less. I mean, and that's just what it is. Now, what does this have to do with Babel? Well, here's what it has to do with Babel. Adam and Eve, very likely, Adam and Eve had to contain the DNA to produce the different skin colors of the world. They had to. There's no other way. That means they were very likely middle brown. Okay, and they were able to produce different groups, and I hope to give you a biology lesson in a minute. Cain getting his wife, I'm not trying to go on tangents, but the Bible says even after Adam, Cain left, you know, he got banished, but then he married somebody when he goes and builds the city of Nod. Well, it had to be a sister. You say, well, that's gross. Well, not in those days. When that's all there is. There's no other explanation for this. Okay, Adam and Eve had children. They had Cain, Abel, and Seth, but the Bible says they had sons and daughters. It doesn't name them all. Tradition says they had 50 or 60 children, some Jewish tradition. So Cain married his sister because there wasn't other people. In fact, it was not illegal. You see that in the Bible. Abraham married his sister. Sarah was his half-sister. Isaac married his cousin. That was expected. You just did that. It wasn't until the law of Moses when you were not allowed to marry direct relatives. There's still, you can still marry cousins today if you want to. We're all related if you want to get down to it. So, but he married his sister. Now, there's a reason for this. I'm going to read this. It says, so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. The last man was made a quickening spirit. Sorry. Thought I had deleted some of these. Forgive me. There's the percentage, by the way, of differences, and that's secular. That came from ABC News. Okay, years ago, when the whole genome project came out, 0.012% is the difference in so-called skin color. And again, I'm not... Okay, I want you to look at this. Remember back in biology when you had to do these, like, squares? Okay, so let's look at this a minute. I'm not trying to get technical, but there's a point to this. Melanin is what causes your skin to be dark or light. We all have brown skin. Everyone on earth has a type of brown. It's either darker or lighter. Okay, you could look at it that way if you wanted. So let's say Adam and Eve were middle brown. And I'm not trying to get overly technical, but look at that. Just imagine that's like DNA and melanin, so capital A, lowercase a, capital B, lowercase b. Okay, so they had children. It's very possible and probable that amongst their children there would have been multiple skin tones. We see that happens still today. There are interracial couples who will have twins. One is white, one's black. That's been documented numerous times. Numerous times. A few years ago, there was a family who had twins. Two white people had twins that were black, and it's because their grandparents. It came from their grandparents. Okay, there wasn't anything weird that went on there. It was their grandparents, and they went and showed it was like one in a million, but it could have happened. But you see here, if they could do that, you know, let's say that somebody, one child gets the capital A from Adam and gets the capital B from Eve, then that means they have dark skin. They all get the little letter from Adam and the little letter from Eve, they had light skin. You put everybody together, you know, across the face of the earth, okay, it's where it came from. And what does this have to do with Babel? I don't want to get too much more into that, but you can see from Adam and Eve how different ethnic groups, different skin shades would have been in their very family, all right, just because of what God put in their blood. And we could keep going forever for that. But let's talk about Babel. Okay, let's look in this room. Let's imagine we are the population at Babel. Okay, and God confuses our language. So Allison and I go off one way, and Luella and Audrey go off one way, and you and Angela go off one way, and Barbara and Burton go off one way, and you two go off one way. Okay, because none of us can communicate. So we all go start our own groups. Okay, that means Allison and I, we made the trek all the way to North America, and we're living in Alaska. So guess what? Over time, probably because you know light and things on the ice and for different reasons, you start getting squinty eyes. Okay, you start having certain skin colors because that was what was in your blood. Those people stay together, they get married, they produce an ethnic group. Well, you guys went off to Japan, the same thing happened to you guys. You start producing the different kind of things. You guys sailed to Australia somehow, and you start producing the Aborigines. So you get all this across the world because those people who have that common language stay together, and that you adapt to the environment you're around, and over time, that's what you produce. Okay, I mean, that's just, God made us that way. It's what is produced over time. And that's how we end up with different ethnic groups. It's not rocket science, but we've made it that way. You want to know, you know, and I could spend a lot of time on this, but racism really has a lot of, I won't say roots, but evolution really did a lot to promote it. They don't teach that anymore. But look at this. Rushton, this professor of psychology, this is years ago, but he ranks the races along an evolutionary scale with blacks at the bottom and Asians at the top. You tell me that's not racist? Why was that not all over the news? The origin of the species, Darwin. Preservation of favored races and the struggle for life. We're all human beings. It's not how he saw it. They're not going to teach that either. Biological arguments for racism have been made common before 1850, but they increased by orders of magnitude following the acceptance of the theory of evolution. You can't read all that, but those are people that were on a remote island, and they call them kindreds of the Stone Age men discovered on Antarctic Island just because they looked a little different. They said that they were remnants of the Stone Age men, cavemen. Just even when I was a child, Neanderthals, they thought were these missing link, and now they just have to recognize that they were humans. Okay, when you start finding tombs with jewelry and evidence of music and things like that, that wasn't a bunch of apes. Those are people that were just a little bit different. People killed, especially the Australian Aborigines. They killed them to try to prove their theories of missing links. Look at this. Here's a quote. At the lowest stage of human mental development are the Australians. Some tribes of the Polynesians and the Bushmen, the Hottentots, and some of the Negro tribes. Ernest Haeckel said that. You're telling me that's not racism? Well, we still shove this down our students' throats. We just conveniently leave that part out of it. Here's a gentleman named Oda Benga. He was put on display in a zoo. He was abducted from his home in the Congo and was put on display in a zoo in the early 1900s because they said he was a missing link. That's the depravity of humanity. This is racism. There are differences, but it's culture, not race. We're all the same. I like this. Said this guy named Day said it's kind of like if all of us are recipes. We have the same ingredients, maybe in different amounts, no matter what kind of cake we turn out to be. We're the same. Something else that conveniently gets forgotten. And I don't want to put too much credibility into this because there's arguments about this, but there's some evidence that, we know some of this happened. During the time after Darwin, to try to prove certain things, they would go dig up dead bodies of the Australian Aborigines because they were considered missing links and send their bones to museums to try to prove all this thing. A lot of evidence they actually murdered some of them so they could send skin samples. It's called Darwin's Body Snatchers. So, perverted. Interracial marriage. Okay, is there any such thing? No. You want to know the only marriage we're not supposed to have? Here it is. Which is the only one up there God says not to do? That bottom one. Has nothing to do with skin color. Anything else. You know, a Christian shouldn't marry a non-Christian, period. There's no exception to that. I know a lot of people will say, well, God led me to this person. I beg to differ. It's not what the scripture says. A non-Christian shouldn't marry a Christian, period. That's the only, that's what God talks against. It has nothing to do with skin color or anything else. I've heard people use the fact that God told the Jews not to marry other cultures as biblical evidence that we should not have so-called interracial marriage. Do you know why he did that? He told them why. It had nothing to do with skin color. He said, because if you go and take these Canaanite women, you're going to follow after their gods. And they did, and they followed after their gods. God had a people preserved to himself for whatever reason he chose. Those are the people he chose to show the world who he was. And that's why he forbade them to do that during that time. Has nothing to do with skin color or why God loving one person more than another. Okay, so anyway, I could go on and go on and go on with that, but I'm not. But confusion. Confusion at Babel. And why? Because people rebelled against God. Anytime we rebel against God, it brings confusion. Rebellion is confusion. Period. And when we do that, we see more confusion. Okay, when we take what God says and change it, we have confusion. When you take what the scripture says, he created them male and female, and now we can say we get to choose that. There's multiple sexes now. There's people who, oh, I'm not boy or girl. Okay, well, I'm sorry, it's not what the scripture teaches. That's not what the scripture, and it causes confusion. That's confusion. Okay, when the Bible says that there was one man and one woman in a union, anything else than that is confusion. One man and five women, that's confusion. Two men, that's confusion. And anytime we take upon ourselves to do to lift ourselves up, God will find a way to bring us down. And you can see it throughout history. This was the greatest event of history for him to do that. And it's significant. And it's important that we don't overlook that. But thank you all for listening to me. I actually got through that tonight. And